boom, boom.
Okay. Well, it's my pleasure to introduce Carl Menton. He got his PhD at Bonn University in 1987, and then he came here as a postdoc, and he was working with me, and it took me about 2 weeks, maybe that was too long, to figure out that I'm not going to be telling him what to do at all. He can be telling me what's interesting to do. A very independent person and has done great things. He was a staff member at SAO after that and became a senior astronomer here. But we lost him in 1996, about 20 years ago, when he became the director of the Max Planck Institute for Radio Astronomy in Bonn. He's won several prizes, including the Philip Morris Research Prize, and he was the 42nd Carl Jansky Lecturer. He's published, 600 papers, pretty modest amount. And he has initiated and been basically the father of the APEX telescope, the Atacama Pathfinder experiment, which is a millimeter, submillimeter telescope that's above ALMA in Chile there. And it's done an amazing thing. It's been in operation for about a decade. And I think he's going to talk to us now about combining many views of star formation at many different wavelengths from radio to infrared, I believe. So, Carl.
Thanks for the flowers, Mark. Okay, so we have, over the years, had quite a number of students doing dissertations on Hymer star formation. And usually when you start a thesis, you have to have some motivational sentences in there. And they go like, the importance of massive star in the universe. Well, they have a large energy output during the whole lifetime. Energetic events, production of heavy elements, and so on. They shape and influence interstellar medium by the UV radiation, stellar winds, and supernova explosions. And then usually they come to the matter of the thesis. Our understanding of the formation is still sketchy because they have very short evolutionary timescales, difficult to locate in the earliest evolutionary stages, and they are far away. And they suffer a huge amount of extinction. And the short time scale is here. This is from a review by Sinica at York. And you see here, for example, the Kelvin-Helmholtz time scale, which is, of course, only gravitational constriction versus accretion luminosity. It's very small, of course. This time scale is not relevant because once nuclear burning starts. But still, even the main sequence lifetimes of 30 solar mass stars, only a few million years. So they are never moved far away from the birthplaces. And studying the birthplaces, therefore, of quite a lot of interest. So astronomers were quite taken in when in the late 60s, infrared astronomy was developed by people like Gary Neugebauer and Eric Becklin, and Gershwin Williams was one of the students there, and he wrote this annual review article, which featured the sentence, protostars are the holy grail of infrared astronomy. That was a very, marquee sentence, and got cited a lot of times. And, of course, at the time, when infrared astronomy was about 15 years old, submillimeter astronomy was not yet developed. And there were other people's with papers with protostars entitled. This is from Steve Wildner, who is in the audience here. And this paper is actually beginning of mineralogy of young stellar objects, because you have the silicate feature, you have this ice features, and so on. The whole science came out of that very productive field. But these are not really protostars, which means still accreting objects deeply embedded, because if they were deeply embedded, you would not see them at 2 micron. So clearly, to observe deeply embedded young stellar objects, real protostars, you have to observe submillimeter radiation And when they grow a little bit older, ionize their environments, you detect them in the radio wavelengths regime. So look at the Orion Nebula. Here you have about 2,000 stars, a million or so years old, the near-infrared picture. There's a star-forming region behind in red here, the famous Kleinman Low Nebula. So you have here a dozen Heimas stars and about 2,000 or so Lomas stars that formed a million years ago. Whereas here, this is a millimeter, 1.2 millimeter image of the Orion. The nebula is over here. And what you see here is not emission from the nebula, but from the Mauna Kea cloud behind the nebula, very prominent. Here, new stars are forming, and also over here. So these are a lot of intermediate Loma stars are forming here. And they are traced by submillimeter, millimeter emission, not by infrared emission. Okay, so my talk will basically give a global view of star formation in the Milky Way. This is, for example, motivated by a picture like this. This is M51 in the H-alpha filter. And you see the bright star-forming regions here that are lined up with the dust lanes. So the young stars, which ionize the surroundings, are still associated with dusty molecular gas in the spiral arms. So therefore, the large-scale structure of a galaxy and the star formation is intimately linked. So to explore this synergy, a few years ago, 6 years ago, I proposed to the European Research Council, I applied for an advanced investigator grant, and this is a nice thing. The European Research Council each year gives starting grants for young researchers, consolidated grants for the medium level researcher, and advanced grants for more senior researchers. And they come with quite a lot of funding. So therefore, you can do projects on a larger scale than you would normally do. So this is actually from the proposal. So it was, we called it close, like global view star formation in the Milky Way. And you basically want to explore stages of massive star formation. And the main data we had at hand, or was were getting at hand, was a submillimeter survey of the galaxy, of a large part of the galaxy, and the CLIMS infrared survey from the Spitzer satellite, which is, of course, very closely connected to the C of A, because the IRAC camera was built here with Giovanni Fazio as a PI. And CLIMS really revolutionized galactic infrared astronomy, and it is a very, very useful data set. I show CLIMS data some several times. So the proposal had three parts. One was dealing with galactic structure, and that concerned mainly with getting distances to star-forming regions. And here my old friend Mark Reed, of course, came in because he's an expert in astrometry of major sources. Then we were want to conduct galactic plane surveys in the in submillimeter range in the dust emission, but also in molecules, a little follow-up there, but also in the radio range with a newly expanded very large array. And then we also had the infrared part, which also characterized more evolved stellar clusters. In this talk, I will possibly not have time to talk about this because I will concentrate on this. So anyway, so there are many interconnections between the different parts. Distances are needed to calculate masses, luminosities. The radio surveys give the ionized gas, but also information on neutral gas mostly from the submillimeter surveys, and so on. And then we hope to arrive on a more complete view of star formation in the Milky Way. So we were successful and could embark on this large program. So the instruments we use are the premier instruments in the wavelength regimes. There's a very large, very long baseline array, 10 telescopes in the United States, which produce milliarcsecond resolution, which we use for astrometry. There's a very large array, which looks just like it looked in 1980, but has been completely refurbished with new receivers. I get to that. There's ALMA. And on the 5,000 meters altitude in Chile, and there's our APEX telescope, which was actually a copy of one of the ALMA prototype antennas. And for the infrared part, we use the ESO Very Large Telescope. Okay, so the first part, mapping the Milky Way, is about determining distances. What you see here are maser sources in the Milky Way. These are known methanol masers. And because of the ambiguity, which I get to in the next slide, they can either the near distance to the sun, which is here, or the far distance. And from the beginning, you don't know at which distance they are, which is a problem. And so we need distances for many reasons, luminosities, masses. So usually for kinematic distance determinations, here's the sun, here's the source, the projection of the radio velocity is exactly the same here. This is solar rotation, galactic rotation is here and here. You get the same radio velocity for these both locations, and you cannot from the beginning determine which one is which unless you use subsidiary information. In addition, this method, which uses the observed radio velocity and the model of the galaxy, is hampered by the fact that galactic star formation have intrinsic motions, peculiar velocities, which can really screw you up when you want to determine a distance. You get a wrong distance if you just assume pure galactic rotation. The method we use is a standard parallax, which is shown here as a cartoon. So you observe several times over a year the position of your maser source relative to background sources, and from the ellipse it prescribes, you get directly the distance. The instrument is a very long baseline array. It's really a fantastic instrument. It's the first VLBI, very long baseline interferometry array, dedicated only for this, and which means you can use it any time. And for our projects, we need, of course, at least 4 observations over a year. So therefore, it's a wonderful instrument, also threatened by closure because of financial situation at the moment. So you support the VLBA. Anyway, so with the VLBA, with 8,000 kilometer baselines, you get a resolution of about 250 microarc seconds at 1 centimeter typical wavelengths we're operating. And you can determine, that depending on the signal, the noise, the centroid, of emission distribution to much better precision, like 10 microarc seconds. So that's what we are dealing with. The optical parallaxes are, 1 milliarc second or so, until Gaia, of course, which is much better today. So therefore, it's definitely instrument. This is comparable to Gaia, by the way. So it's a great instrument for parallaxes. There's another such array in Japan called VERA, also dedicated array for this parallax work. And as I already said, you measure over the course of the year the position and get the parallax. We basically switch between the masers of the quasar every 15 seconds to cancel systematic effects and get this high precision. Okay, so what you get is your source prescribes such a corkscrew motion typically. This is a parallax, which is superposed with the proper motion of the source. If you separate out the superposed motion, you get the parallax. So fitting this, you only have three parameters. The parallax in A and B at distance. So it's a very constrained problem, and of course the peculiar motions are also overdetermined. So it's a problem that is solvable and results in high precision measurements. The sources we use are maser sources. These are bright and compact. You have to have compact sources, otherwise you don't see them with a high resolution. And of the known maser sources, particularly water vapor masers, 22 gigahertz, are suitable in methanol masers. Now, the VLBA receivers only had receivers for methanol 112.2 gigahertz, which can be strong, but there's another one which actually detected myself in 1991, which is much stronger, 10 or 200 times stronger. And but the BBA didn't have receivers, and it was, you know, so we couldn't do this. And after a while, we had ran out of these masers. We had done them all, which was strong enough. We still have water masers, but we wanted to do this line. And for that, we could use money from the ERC grant and also Max Planck Society funds to finance an additional receiver band for very long baseline array. So we could do this methanol line. And before we started the big project, we measured the parallax to W3OH, the famous star from the region. And then in the 1970s, Roberta Humphreys from O-star distances, using their magnitudes and the spectral type, derived the distance of about 2.2 kiloparsec, whereas from the kinematics, from the radial velocities, you get a distance of 4.3 kiloparsec. So that's an example of a big problem. And our parallax, which was here published in Nature, in Science by Juillet, et al., Mark and me, and Jindu Zeng, is 1.95 plus minus 0.4 kiloparsec. And we also measured the parallax from the water masers, which is in the errors consistent. So it's the method seemed to work. Here's the parallax signature, here with the proper motions removed, and it was clear with that this source is the Perseus arm and not in the outer arm, and the large peculiar velocity is responsible for the wrong kinematic distance. Okay, so then Mark wrote a big proposal, VBA legacy program for over 5,000 hours observing time, which called Bar and Spiral Structure Legacy Survey, which is VBA key science project. And of course, the acronym is a little bit labored, you know, but it was chosen because of this person, Friedrich Wilhelm Bessel, who measured the first parallax, the 6160, in 1838. So to honor him, very remarkable mathematician and astronomer, physicist, so very much a scientist. Okay, so at this Bessel team, Mark is the guy behind all of it. He holds it together. And Tom Dame here has become an invaluable help over the years as an expert of galactic structure, CVA. And Andreas Puntala, who was here as a pre-doc with Mark, actually, the CVA, is leading, you know, the Bonsai Jingwu Zhang on the Chinese side. And we had a lot of postdocs over the years, students, mostly from, many from China, but also from Korea and Japan and other countries in Europe. So it was a very nice team. Many of them were working at the MPIFR at one time. So it's a good project. And if you want to hear more about Bessel, ask Mark to give a talk, you know, obviously. And I only show a very short summary here. It's much, much richer material out of there. This is just one nice example. This is actually not done with the VLBA, but with the European VLBI network, because in the beginning, the VLBA didn't have 6.7 gigahertz capability, but the EVN had. And this is another example. This is a famous Cygnus X star for the region, and we did five sources here, and they all come with distances between 1.3 and 1.5 kiloparsec, except this source, which is a very famous one of actually the Steve Wilner sources, 3.3 kiloparsec is obviously a different spiral arm. And this region was also to be thought to be at more than 2 kiloparsec. Just one example. Another example is a Perseus arm, and we find a dearth of masers in this part of the arm, which actually was confirmed really to have little star formation. So these are actually the peculiar motion, the proper motions we measure for the maser sources. So it's really a very successful project. And as I said, I can only scratch the surface here. If you want to plot the rotation curve of the Milky Way, this is here. This is from a summary paper by Mark, coming in 2014. So we use it to revise the galactic rotation speed, the IU values 220 kilometers per second to 240 kilometers per second, and the distance to galactic center, pretty close to 8.5 kilopascals. If we get 8.34 plus minus 0.16, so that's essentially the Bessel project, which delivered distances. And as I said, we have about 100 mesos as parallaxes, and we clearly can define the spiral arms in terms of the pitch angles. So this is quite interesting, because it really, for the first time, I think, lays clearly out the spiral structure. Note, even Gaia, we do 100 sources, Gaia does a billion sources, but none of the sources we do can be done by Gaia because of the obscuration, but that's the Milky Way. So with the masers, you get the prime star-forming complexes in the Milky Way, which Gaia can't do. So that's certainly a very important point. And these are, of course, the distances of these sources are very interesting to know. Now, this is, again, the near far distance, there's the Sun, and we haven't done any work here with VLBI because that's not doable from the Northern Hemisphere. And Mark is very busy at the moment to establish VLBI in Australia, so we can also get distances for this part of the galaxy, which is of particular interest for the next part of my talk. Okay, and this is actually the first parallax measured from Australia with existing telescopes, so it can be done also down under. Okay, so the next part of my talk is a comprehensive, that was the second partial project of GLOSTAR, a comprehensive galactic plane, supplement radio star formation surveys. And what I show here in red is dust emission, and in the lighter blue is infrared emission from the galactic plane. This time with the APEX telescope and the radio part with the VLA. So APEX is a 12-meter telescope, and when the first prototype antennas for ALMA were commissioned, I persuaded the Max Planck Society to finance a copy of one of them, the one built by Vertex in Germany. That's actually a North American antenna. ALMA has three different types of antennas. This is a North American antenna. It's the same type of antenna as a Greenland telescope antenna. And it has, we also wanted these Naismith cabins, which are not in the ALMA antennas. I think the Greenland telescope has them. So these are very important for us because they can house instrumentation. So ALMA has all the instrumentation that has a great focus here. So we operate APEX with Onsala Space Observatory, which had a lot of standing interest in millimeter astronomy in Chile. They had the ZEST telescope operating in Brazil for many years, together with ESO. So we joined these observatories, and Chile gets 10%, and the rest of the time is split here between the other three. And it's a great antenna, so we have better than 50 micron surface accuracy, operate between 200 micrometer, 2 millimeter, since 10 years. And this is not correct. It's in operation since September 2006. And we do heterodyne receivers, which do spectral line observations, and also bolometer receivers, which are very broadband and sensitive for continuum radiation. And this is Atlas Gal, the APEX telescope, large survey of the galaxy. So this is a complete sensor, 350 gigahertz, or 870 micron of the galactic plane observable to us. And we detect protostellar condensations with masses down to tens of solar masses. Throughout the Milky Way, actually, it's more like 100 solar masses. And these are total masses, gas masses, not only dust masses. And we spend 1,000 hours of observing time on it. And you know, why is sublimeter emission so interesting? Well, if you look at a source of dust, this here is a typical very dark cloud, and you actually see absorption at 6.7 micron, but emission at 1.2 millimeter or 870 micrometer. And whereas the extinction doesn't give you usually any quantitative information, the emission does, because it's usually optically thin, and the measured flux density isn't essentially proportional to the hydrogen column density in the region. And basically, you count the protons in the region. And so you get the hydrogen column density, and if you get the distance, you also get the mass of the region, and modulated by the dust temperature, which you have to determine from a spectral line, a spectral energy distribution. And that was a real bottleneck, because it was impossible to get data points here at the high frequencies. You know, from the ground, you can only observe to essentially terahertz or less than terahertz, but you never get the wind points, and then you cannot constrain the blackbody maximum, which gives you temperature. So that changed fundamentally with Herschel. I get to that. Okay, this is a large APEX bolometer camera, La Boca. It has about it had about 300 elements. It's kind of deteriorating a little bit. And there's a semiconductor wafer, which is built by Ernst Kreiser. And there's a horned ray. This is built also by our institute. It's all built by our institute. And this is about has about 8 times more pixels than the famous Scuba camera on the JCMT, and was for a long time the biggest sub-millimeter camera. Now, of course, has Scuba 2 with 2 times 5,000 elements. So we are no longer competitive, but we also, of course, proliferate our equipment. They get back to that. Okay, so that's La Boca. This is again the Atlas Gal survey. This is the covered area of the Milky Way. Most of the inner galaxy is actually covered. So basically 90% of the galaxy inside the solar circle. The solar circle is indicated here with a white line. And so, and this is the clump mass for temperature of 20 Kelvin, plus minus 5 Kelvin. And you see here at the galactic center distance, you discover 100 solar masses. So basically that's a ball game, and you discover 1,000 solar masses anywhere in the galaxy. This is at the nominal sensitivity of the ray, which is about 60 millijanski per beam. Okay, this is the whole submillimeter emission. And bolometers, because of the observing technique, you chop out large-scale structure. So you get really mostly information on the small structure. To remedy that, we took the data from the Planck spacecraft and added it, and we get the whole emission, or the extended emission and the compact emission, and it's really a beautiful image. This is the infrared image. This is a composite of 3.6 micron, 4.5 micron, and 8 micron from the CLIM survey with Spitzer. And, you know, look at this, for example. Look at this here. This is a famous source, the galactic center, which is bright and sublimeter, but shows actually absorption in the infrared. And there are many other occasions. Actually, these infrared absorption features have their own name. They're called infrared dark clouds, and they are, some of them are signs of star formation, some are quiescent, but they are really characterized by tremendous column density. To be absorbing at 8 micron, you need really AV of 100 or so. So really, these are very high extinction region, and they show very bright submillimeter emission. And as I said, from the submillimeter emission, you get the mass of the regions. This is a beautiful composite done by ESO, which again shows those things really here. And it's really quite spectacular. And again, the red is the dust. Particularly in the lighter colors are the infrared. So, look for example here, this region, which is a bubble. Spitzer detects a lot of bubbles in the interstellar medium, infrared bubbles, which are basically blown by stellar winds in the interstellar medium. And the red is a submillimeter emission to blow this up. So, clearly, you can make a case for triggered star formation if you find, for example, signs for active star formation in these sublimeter structures here, which you actually do in some cases. So, I give you a very general overview, but many of these specific things have been studied already in detail, and a lot of interesting results obtained, which I cannot discuss here because I have no time. This is the galactic center region again, the apex and the Planck data. This is HGSB2, which is a few billion solar masses, very massive star form region forming very many O stars. And the Greek center itself is here. You have this loop structure seen also by Herschel. So it's this is not really explored yet. There was no other sublimeter map with this detail. So anyway, get back to the center a little bit later. This is a plot of the number of sources per bin, just as a function of galactic longitude. And you see clearly groupings at the major star forming complexes here, and the spiral arms, Sagittarius arm, Norma arm here, and Scutum and Centaurus arm. So this is a crude way of displaying it, but you clearly can connect this the survey to the overall structure of the Milky Way. We see lots of filaments. Some of them are very large, to degree scales, which are 100 parsec or larger. So clearly coherent structures. And I have no time to talk about it, but we also did this in spectral lines, and we also show that they are velocity coherent. So they're really not only projection. And this is an attempt to quantify these filaments. So we did use sophisticated structure finding algorithms, and we identified about 500 filaments with an average distance of 3.8 kiloparsec, which are clearly associated with spiral arms, have a medium mass of 1,000 solar masses, and 20% of them have signs of massive star formation. So we also, of course, analyzed the survey for compact sources, did a number of different extraction algorithms, and you find some examples here. This is semi-automated, and in the end, we arrived at more than 10,000 compact sources, which we all cataloged. We had two different catalogs of different increasing quality, and we clearly have provided a very nice database for future studies. Okay, in addition, we started a big follow-up program at other wavelengths. First of all, we tried to get distances for all of our sources. We did spectroscopy to study the astrochemistry of the regions, and we also zoomed in with ALMA on some regions. So this is a very massive follow-up program. And first thing is to get the luminosities. Here, I alluded already to the problem to construct a SED for these sources, because long ago, for a long time, we only had this sublimeter point here. But Novi Spitzer, which also did the galactic plane survey called Heigel, we get all this additional data point for all our compact sources, which are mutually observed. So in the part, it's certainly in the part of the galaxy where we have sublimeter data. And this is a resolution of APEX, which compares very well to Spitzer resolution, to the Herschel resolution. So that way we get typically two components here, 130 Kelvin components, one warmer component from the peak of the SEDs, two peaks of the SEDs. And now Herschel is gone. In the future, we have SOFIA to provide this database with the new Hawk Plus instrument and forecast to provide data here. So we can get future data with SOFIA, because with Herschel gone, there is certainly no other far infrared mission on the horizon for many years, many decades maybe. Okay, so other with the spectral line follow-ups is a famous ammonia molecule with its well-known hyperfine structure, an excellent molecular cloud thermometer from which you get temperature, gas temperatures, and fitting kinematic distances with all the drawbacks. We get distances for about 2,000 sources, and that way, clearly homogeneous our data set. We actually cross-checked distances from the kinematics method with parallax and got good agreement. Okay, then we had many molecular line follow-ups. velocity in life, it's information and physical condition, chemical conditions. And I really have no time to go into any detail, but I just mentioned that we mapped very many molecules in different transitions and got the rotational temperatures determined the state of excitation of the gas. With different telescopes, we observed not only with APEX, but also with RM 30 meter telescope, the MOPR telescope in Australia. APEX only does these wavelength searches, but many transitions, many molecules have their ground state transition this band, so it's important. This is an example. Today you have amazing spectroscopic facilities. In the old days, you had only like 10 years ago, 500 megahertz bandwidth. Now you have 16 gigahertz simultaneous bandwidth with excellent resolution. And the receiver bandpass is also very wide, so you really can very effectively study this whole spectra. In particular, complex molecules are of interest, like this is from a review by Eric Kerbs and Evine van Dishoek. And this is a star from a core. Once the protostar star ignites, it evaporates molecules from the ice mantles around dust grains, which I alluded to in the beginning. And these molecules evaporate at a certain each at a certain distance from the star, which is given by the luminosity, because they sublimate all at different temperatures. And for example, methanol, the methanol ice, which has grown on the dust grains, evaporates, the gas phase abundance increases by orders of magnitude and produces a tremendously rich sublimeter spectrum, and the star's strong far infrared radiation pumps the maser. So there's a connection of methanol masers and the presence of the protostar. This effect actually gives you the possibility to establish a crude evolutionary scheme. This is a spectrum characteristic for sources which are quiescent at 70 micron. These are the sources which have nothing embedded, no protostar yet ignited. They're very boring spectrum, just a CO line and hardly anything else. Now, these are 24 micron quiescent, and they still have a lot of extinction and not much going on. But once the source has definitely a power source at center, infrared bright, the spectrum lights up because all these ice mantles get evaporated and the molecules go into gases and produce this very rich spectrum. And even when the star has started ionized, a lot of it is still shielded and the spectrum prevails. So this is also the same frequency range. So you see that just from looking at the spectra, you can establish a good evolutionary sequence, which is also shown here. You have pristine clump, 70 micro dark, nothing else. But then if you add a little bit infrared radiation, you get quite different molecular appearance. And you can use molecules to establish such sequences. Okay, so the Atlas-Gal data are all obtainable from a data server at our institute. You can get these postage stamps. This is sublimeter radiation. This is sublimeter radiation contours together with Spitzer color. And you also can get all the spectral line data available. So it's really a resource, and it has produced a tremendous amount of follow-up studies. There's even a YouTube movie which had more than 300,000 views. So you know, if you collaborate with ESO, they have a public relations department which is just not to beat. So it's really one of the advantages. Okay, so as I already mentioned, we zoomed in on these sources with ALMA and got time with much higher resolution. So the Atlas-Gal resolution is about 20 arcseconds, so we got few arcsecond resolution and even higher resolution. This is the Atacama compact array, which is this compact array of small antennas, which is sensitive for large-scale structure. And we zoomed in on the sources and find the fragment, many of them in one or two clumps, and many of them The most some of them really retain all the sublimated flux on the small scale structure. These are very massive clusters really forming. And this is work in progress, so I cannot talk too much about it. So again, these are the original proposers of Atlas Cal. It was in the Max Planck Society. It was from our institute and the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy in Heidelberg. Thomas Hedding, the director, and Henrik Porter, who many of you who know very well, because he worked here at the CFA for a number of years. And we have collaborators from ESO and also from Chile. And it's been quite a good project, and not to mention a long list of students who all worked on it. Okay, I already talked about proliferation. SCUBA 2 is working well. They have 2 times 5,000 pixels at 450 and 850 micron. We hopefully will have soon 3,500 pixels at 170 micron, 22,000 pixels at 350 micron. So that will really kick something. At the same time, our colleagues at ESO are collaborating with CEA in Saclay to produce 5,000 pixels come at shorter wavelengths, 250, 350, 450 micron. So these are, we'll hope they will not come 2015. So, but hopefully 2017. So this is an old future, sorry. Okay, so Atlas Cal is one of many galactic plane surveys. So there are the infrared surveys to Mars, which was of course an old sky survey, has intrinsically the galactic plane, tremendously successful GLIMS here with Spitzer, IRAC camera, the Heigel with Herschel, the surveys in molecular lines, which also will be done by APEX in the near future because get multi-beam receiver arrays. In the radio, there are a number of surveys, one at long wavelengths, one for 4 gigahertz, with the Canadian Galactic Plane Survey, that's very large surveys and serious, and with the VLA, and I will talk about our closer survey at 4 to 8 gigahertz. So switching from the submillimeter to radio wavelengths, let's look at the Orion Nebula. It's basically you have the whole nebula started, the ionization is dominated by one hot star, an O7 star, Theta 1c Orionis, which is here somewhere. And this is ionized gases, very long wavelengths. If you put the Orion Nebula at the galactic center, you get something like this. This here is paper by Katrin Ehmer, who was also here as a pre-doc with Mark, and the A44 gigahertz, and this source is about a Jansky at 8 kiloparsec, which would mean 400 Jansky at the Orion Nebula distance, and the Orion Nebula is about 300 Jansky. So this wimpy source here is the Orion Nebula. So to compare it with the Orion Nebula, actually dug out a very ancient single-dish map from Schrammel and Metzger 1969, which has comparable spatial, it has a little bit of a factor of 2 or 3 worse spectral angular resolution than this one. Actually, spatial resolution, really. It has, of course, 2 arc minute resolution, it's 5 arc second, but at the galactic center, it's the same spatial resolution. Okay, so meaning you can detect compact H2 regions, your Orion Nebula is defined as a compact H2, not a large H2 region, anywhere in the Milky Way. With VLA sensitivity. That's the basic message. And not only Orion nebulas, but many much more compact and weaker regions. And the instrument here is a VLA. So this is a completely new instrument. It was built in 1980, looked exactly like this in 1980. This is a deconfiguration with 1 kilometer baselines. Telescopes can be moved apart up to 30-ish kilometer baselines. And synthesize beams between like 50 milliarc second and tens of arc seconds. So it's a very interesting instrument. And with the VLA expansion project, you basically transform for moderate price this instrument to an instrument which, casually speaking, has more than 10 times astronomical capability of the VLA in terms of sensitivity, frequency access, image fidelity, everything, you know. And I don't go into details here, I don't have the time for that, but just mention the frequency coverage. The old VLA only covered the blue frequency band here, very narrow, dictated by the technology at the time. The expanded VLA, called the Jansky VLA now, covers all frequencies from 1 to 50 gigahertz. That's really great. So we decided to, as part of the CloStar proposal, to put in a blind server with a VLA. This means essentially mosaicing. So you observe successively different beams. The field of view is given by the size of a single antenna. And we do 4 to 8 gigahertz. We can. The old VLA had a bandwidth of 100 megahertz. Now you can do 4 gigahertz simultaneously. That alone is incredible advantage. There's of course radio, man-made radio frequency interference, but we still can use 2 gigahertz bands. We can do full polarization. We do it in B and D array, which synthesize beams of about 2 arc seconds and about 12 arc seconds. And we add Effelsberg single dish data to get the missing information on the large hit structure the interferometer doesn't see. In the end, we will have a whole view of a large portion of the galactic plane with 2 arc second resolution. So that will be really something. And not only do we do the continuum, I mentioned the continuum. With the bad bandwidth and the polarization, we can separate free from synchrotron radiation. But we also do simultaneously 6.7 gigahertz methanol masers, several radio recombination lines, and 4.8 gigahertz formaldehyde absorption, which all happen to be doable simultaneously. So we get the dynamics of the neutral gas on the masers, the absorption, and from the ionized gas from spectral lines. So this will be really very ambitious survey. I have no time to go through it. There's a number of people involved. Of course, Mark is a prominent member of the team. And we do this all with really incredible sensitivity. I don't go to details, but give you just some comparison at the end. So this is a preliminary image, just with a D-ray resolution. This is a pilot field we are concentrating on at the moment. And what you see here is the W43, which is a starburst region, which has a tremendous amount of star formation. It's a galactic starburst region. This is a supernova remnant W44. So it's really this incredible wealth of detail in this. And this is only the low resolution data. This is a galactic center. There are still some artifacts in here. The data reduction is tremendously difficult, and it's completely software limited because there's no adequate software there. You actually cannot use the software NRO prescribes. You have private software developed by Bill Cotton at NRO. So it's a shame, you know, but you cannot do this properly. Anyway, look at the arches here. You know, these are well known for a very long time. But look at these features. We, of course, can get very high resolution, unprecedented resolution sensitivity. Look at this, all these shells. These are all supernova remnants here in the galactic center. And I think many of them were not recognized before. There's a source with a shell and a complex zone in the middle. Incredible amount of detail. And here, in comparison with the submillimeter image, you know, it's there are even some shells that repeat in the submillimeter and the radio. And it will be really fun to work on this, but it's also very challenging. It will be very challenging. This demonstrates when you combine the high resolution and the low resolution data, you get most of the structure, not all. For that, you need a single dish, and so it's really will be great database in the end. Of course, you have extragalactic sources. These are a few radio galaxies. Many of our point sources are extragalactic, will be interesting to distinguish them from galactic ones. Of course, galactic are predominantly thermal, extragalactic non-thermal. Okay, and I just want to add some pictures here of the, this is a few randomly selected continuum sources. This is a compact heterogeneous, ultra-compact heterogeneous, and the hyper-compact heterogeneous, very compact source. And this is radio recombination line emission, and these are spectra. So This is actually produced by stacking seven different recombination lines for cyclotenoids. This is formaldehyde, again, three regions. Interestingly, you observe formaldehyde emission absorption from the target region, but also from intervening spiral arms. So, but you would actually detect some masers of formaldehyde, which are very rare. But anyway, so very nice databases. I should mention this is a master's thesis project by Emrol Sarkar, first student from Bangladesh we ever had. This is Hans Guillen from Canada. It is a master's thesis and now his PhD on the formaldehyde. This is by Chandrasekhar Vuragesan, very nice master thesis. The methanol masers, here's the maser, there's sub-millimeter emission, it ran, there's radio continuum emission. The maser is dead on the sub-millimeter emission. And this is just a few sources. And you know, there was a survey done in Australia only targeting methanol masers, and they did a very good job. But we are much, we're a factor of five more sensitive than then, and we discover 30% more sources in the field. So really, particularly given the fact that methanol masers, this is kind of a evolutionary scheme, molecular cloud to OB association. Methanol masers are associated with this hot molecular course I described before, and they really mark the exact position of protostars. So getting the methanol masers and comparing them, for example, with radio continuum emission, which from the protostars, which you also helped exact, will be very interesting. And James Urquhart has done actually comparison, find that 90% of methanol masers in our Atlas graphite are associated with massive dust condensation. So this will be really interesting because the interferometry observations will pinpoint the exact locations of the protostars. And we can compare them with high resolution observations from ALMA and really understand the kind of 100 AU environment of these protostars, which is unprecedented. But that's future music. It is still a way to get there. Okay, so we actually may be approaching the Holy Grail at one point, so I don't know. Okay, so I still have some time left. I actually had now my summary slides, but I can also talk about a little bit about the infrared part. So let me close with that. So this is deal with near-infrared observations to determine spectral photometry of massive young open clusters. So this is, was a very influential paper by Charlie Larder and his sister Elizabeth. Came out in 2003, Embedded Clusters in Molecular Clouds. This was essentially based on 15 years of near-infrared data, and it showed that 90% of the stars form embedded clusters, that form in embedded clusters, for 90%, almost all stars form in embedded clusters, and many of them rich clusters. So it really was a very important result. But the sample was limited. It was 76 clusters, all in solar neighborhood within 2.5 kiloparsec, a limited mass range. Now, that was, of course, with the technology at the time, the observational status of the time. Nowadays, you can go further in the galaxy. So, and the third part of the CLOSTAR project was devoted to near-infrared studies of candidate clusters associated with giant molecular cloud, to identify the massive stars ionized in H2 regions, and to map and date the various episodes of star formation of a given giant molecular cloud, and also to derive spectrophotometric distances. This is, of course, interesting. This is from the very famous paper by Georges Alain. This is a map of the Milky Way, mid-70s, suggestion of spiral arms. And they basically, for a number of regions, they do spectroscopy in the H-gamma optical line and they compare the apparent magnitude with optical photometry. They get spectral types of stars, and then they can place them in an AR-HR diagram. For that, they get the distances. So this is a classic spectrophotometric distance method. And we wanted to establish that for the infrared wavelengths, because in the this code is supposed to be centered here, and it basically was to indicate that you can see in the inner galaxy. So, and nowadays we all have these unbiased infrared surveys, and in particular these near-infrared surveys find clusters, and the submillimeter surveys find protoclusters. So we have a very rich data set, and the IR clusters are shown here in red, and you move into the inner galaxy. Now, these clusters are not exactly easy to find. Even massive clusters, like the Arches and the Quintuple clusters, which are really very massive clusters, several times 10 to the 4 solar masses, are not very conspicuous in infrared maps. You have to look very carefully, but you find them if you do that. And quite a number of very massive clusters were found recently. And as I said, we wanted to study them in the CLOSTAR project. And we used the VLT for that, which has this very nice Symphony, which is an imaging spectrometer, and is also spiffy, so you can do imaging spectroscopy. You can do few arc second size patches of which you get spectra. And this is has been quite successful. These are a few famous regions, W31, W43, prominent star form regions. These are the Symphony images, and we extracted, for example, spectra for number of stars here, and very rich data sets. You get all kinds of things like CO band and emission towards several objects and so on. I can't go to details, but only want to point out that if we, for some of five stars, compare the spectrophotometric distance we get here with the Bessel trigonometric parallaxes, we find good agreement. So the first conclusion is that in particular, it's 01 stars. The 01 to 03 stars are quite well suited for spectrophotometric parallaxes. This is rudimentary, and it's just a demonstration, but much more further work is needed. But it shows that nowadays you can also in the near infrared, that brings back the loop to the Willner et al. Paper, and really you can also in the infrared study young stars, although they are more developed than the really deeply embedded objects. Okay, so I hopefully demonstrate you that we got a whole bunch of really nice data in the course of these programs. A lot of people were involved at our institute. Our administrator, Viola Tegetov, without her, there would be no CLOSTAR, because 2 weeks before the deadline, she came to me and said, I think you should write a proposal for this. I said, no, that's too much work. No way, Jose. And then I was actually at a conference at Caltech and for 3 days, so 3 days before the deadline. And there was no proposal. And here, Mark and Andreas Buntal of Friedrich Warowski, I gave my talk on the first day, then I didn't leave the hotel room for 2 days. So we wrote this report, it's true. But anyway, without Viola, would not have come. And a whole lot of scientists, many of them were financed through the grant, a lot of students, and in particular, Mark has been an indispensable collaborator on this. Bill Cotton from NIO2 for the radio part. So, of course, when you submit such a project proposal, you have to promise deliverables. And what we promised and delivered is a catalog of high precision distances and sensitive images of mass luminosity distribution, physical chemical properties of large sample of star forming regions, and also high angular resolution multi-wavelength continuum image of galactic plane, an extended list of methanol, meson, and ultracopage 2 regions, and the infrared photometry, and so on. Of course, the grant ended in 2015, April, but the work continues indefinitely. That's clear. And so with that, We come to the end, from the deliverables, the formal deliverables, to the real answers we try to find. So we have identified a real, very large portion of all the size of hyper star forming, star formation in the galaxy, the distance luminosities. We are establishing an evolutionary scheme, and from the masers and the very compact continuum mission, we will find the exact locations at which stars form, massive stars form, and we get great data on the physical chemistry of the newly formed stars' environments. And with that, I thank for your attention.
Sure,
there will be a guy that will also do it, but so there will be attempts to connect to those. Absolutely. But I'm not exactly aware of what's going on.
Not quite sure it's meant by gaps.
Oh, you mean gaps in the extinction?
Yes.
I thought,
the extinction range is where you got nothing.
No, the barless windows, for example, that are off the plane, you know, it's not exactly. There's really the extinction is where, as you see from Mars, there's suddenly the emission everywhere. You know, there's no way. If you see anything with atmosphere, it's 20 or more magnitudes of extinction. That's the point. So I thought you were talking that they could connect Gaia and do that better. So that may be possible. Maybe like the, I showed this famous Cygnus X region at 1.4 kilopascals. That certainly came in on the Gaia.
Other questions?
All right.
Go.
So you started with this thing about finding the high mass stars.
Yes.
It wasn't clear to me, because I don't know much about this field, I suppose, how you pick those out from the using this millimeter data.
Well, your submillimeter is a mass tracer. So basically, you observe condensations which have a certain mass. And then you use an IMF, for example, you get a total gas mass of the condensation, and you get like the total mass of the Orion, of the stars in the Orion Nebula, supposedly a few thousand solar masses. So if you find a gas plant with this kind of mass, then it's a very good possibility that a new cluster will form there.
Other questions? Let me just ask one. I was very interested in the spectra they showed at 350 gigahertz with the 70 micron sources, meaning not much excitation. How fine a time scale do you think you can get for the
That's difficult. That's difficult. And that's very difficult. It's not easy because you have no dynamical information, essentially. So, and all of the time scales that we propose, I don't really believe in it. So once you have an H2 bridge, it's different, then you can measure expansion, but that's very difficult. It's something you do.
Okay, any other questions? One more try.
Okay.
So I've been struggling with whether to ask this question for a very long time. So why are there so many or so few O stars? Because there are a few more, they blow everything away, there are fewer, there will be nothing going on for you to look at.
That's a good question.
Is it all designed for you?
Well, how many O stars? If you look at Wikipedia, 120,000 O stars, what does it mean? The O star is not O star. If you have a massive O star or not so massive O star, it's a huge difference. So I am not even sure everybody knows what you mean with this number of O stars. You know, but it's.
But at the high end, if you had three or five times as many, all of that lovely stuff that you were looking at would be
better. It's a good question.
So it seems tuned by some process that you're not actually right now on top of.
I don't know. It's no good answer for that.
I think they might consider that the answer is we don't understand that.
You understand what those guys do.
Yeah, possibly. Yeah. What you can do is, of course, identify all the clumps which have the potential for wall stones. And from my rough estimate, would be at least a few thousand, 5,000 easily. But that isn't as you want to do, I haven't done it.
Okay, well, let's thank Carl again.